We are discreetly removed from the madness of yesterday on the campuses and in the academic journals, though an apostolate survives, and in what Kingman Brewster has described as an eerie tranquility is perhaps regrouping to strike again. At what? At America is the easiest way to put it. Meanwhile, illiterature is quickly growing. Examining the particular luridities of the counterculture, most prominent this season is Arnold Beichman's Nine Lies About America. Mr. Beichman, to the intense disappointment of his critics, is not an American right-winger. He is a lecturer at the University of Massachusetts in political science. He was city editor of the left-wing PM in New York City years ago. He has worked for a dozen years with the trade union movement. He took early the side of the separatists in Algeria. He briefed Senator Robert Kennedy on South Africa, to which country he was denied a visa the second time around. But he could not see the correspondence between the country he inhabits and the country as described by our militantly dissatisfied, among whom is Mr. Dotson, Rader. He has been a member of the Students for Democratic Society, and he figured prominently in the Columbia riots of 1968. He has edited one book and written two, I Ain't Marching Anymore, a title which is self-explanatory, and Government Inspected Meat and Other Summer Fun Things, a title which is not. He is contributing editor of Evergreen Review, an avant-garde journal with heavy sexual preoccupations. I should like to begin by asking Mr. Beichman whether he detects any sense of guilt among those American intellectuals who were indulgent of the militants during the recent Woolly War.
No, I don't think there's any sense of guilt. Since they've sat in judgment on everybody else, the judge never finds himself guilty. I would say that perhaps secretly they may feel they made an error, but I don't see that there's been any great revulsion from what they did to the American university, and it turned out to have been a pretty disastrous thing for themselves as well.
Are you saying there's no such thing as a penitent class among intellectuals? Is this a historical observation?
Well, yes, because the intellectual, as a rule, takes the position he's never been wronged. For example, in the current issue, or an issue a few weeks ago, I guess, Jack Newfield has a letter in the Village Voice, in which he talks, he describes how he lied for Bella Abzug. Bella Abzug, he said he had heard personally.
He wouldn't want to tell the truth about it. That wouldn't be chivalrous.
Yeah, well, you see, he said, I was there, he says, Jack Newfield, a distinguished intellectual, if I may call him that, without contradiction. He says, I was there when Bella said in 1970 she was against the Jets for Israel. And then I watched her deny she ever said it. And finally, I lied and denied she ever said it so that she might defeat Barry Farber. I am now ashamed of all that.
Oh, then he is penitent.
But you see, isn't it amazing how this apology and this act of penitence can become a sort of an act of arrogance? Because if one had said at that time, it's like in the old days, if you forgive this invidious comparison, when people were saying that Stalin was a monster, a despot, a killer, a destroyer, a genocidist, and so on. There were many people who lied for Stalin, but when they heard what Khrushchev did in his expose speech, they suddenly said, oh yes, Stalin was always right. Now, they didn't admit, in a sense, that they had committed a great crime against truth. They turned their confession into an act of virtue. And I think Newfield is saying the same thing. See, I've told the truth finally at last, but how
confession
about the people?
Mr. Buckley would say confession is a virtue. I don't find the parallel between Bella Abzug and Stalin particularly.
Well, I wasn't making that, and that's a very cheap, you know, left-wing trick to suggest that I was comparing Bella Abzug and Stalin. She hasn't got his talent, for one thing, but she might, given the opportunity.
You mean once women's lib succeeds, she will envy Stalin?
Oh, she's, I would say, one of the original knitters at the guillotine, probably reincarnated.
Yeah. Well, Mr. Beichman has said some provocative things, Mr. Rader. Do you think it is invidious to compare some of the tactics of the people who shut down Columbia, for instance, with the tactics of the young Stalinists or the young Hitlerites during the 30s?
Well, I think the comparison since 69, I've seen widely in print between the radicals and that particular period in American history and the Weimar Republic. And it's the argument usually goes that in expanding the limits of public tolerance for dissent, violence, and so on, that you so eat away at democratic institutions that they collapse. And I've never found the I find culturally, in terms of the arts, a certain correspondence between this period and the Weimar Republic. I politically don't see a correspondence.
Well, did you mean to press this analogy? Because if nobody wants to press it, I'll let it go. But something caused you
to
bring up.
Well, I disagree first with the concept of the word radical in terms of the students. I disagree very strongly that they were radical. What they were is very much like some of their elders, say like Professor Andrew Hacker, who in his book talks about the end of America.
Yeah.
What he really is sort of a conservative. I don't mean a conservative in the sense, Bill, that I would talk about you as a conservative, kind of a sense of elitism. Americans have no right to think well of themselves. It should be denied to them. This kind of superiority that the intellectual has towards the great unwashed masses. And I think very largely the attitude of many of the young at Columbia, whom I knew as a fellow graduate student in 68 and 69 and in 70, was very much a contempt. As they were saying, all power to the people, you always wondered, what people were they talking about?
What people were you talking about?
All power, you have it in your book, Defiance, all power to the people is your signature line.
Mm-hmm.
What people are you talking about?
It's basically a populist position.
But what people? Not the hard hats. Obviously, you wouldn't want them to.
No, I think the hard hats. I think the basic thrust of the new left, and that's a bad term, but the new left, until I would say 69, when the Weatherman was born. I think we always make a mistake because we assume the new left is Marxist, which it's not. And
is it Leninist?
No, I think essentially it's
or just a cultural
nihilist.
No, I think in spirit it's basically 18th century. That's how it began,
1860
Constitution. And that coupled with a populism. And if you read the Port Huron Statement of SDS, which was really the beginning of the New Left, in the context now, it reads as a very highly constitutionalist, highly moderate, social democratic kind of statement. What occurred in 68 and 69 is that the new left, for various reasons, began to adopt Marxist, or an overlay of Marxist terminology on what really, in fact, wasn't Marxist consciousness. Because I don't think traditional Marxism is particularly applicable to the American situation. This, coupled with disillusionment with American institutions coming largely out of the response of those institutions to what were rather good-natured, traditional protests of grievances, or the war.
Wait a minute. Were good-natured? You lost me there.
Well, I think they were good-natured. And the resulting disillusionment produced bitterness, resentment, and very severe alienation, in the sense that you could no longer work constitutionally, and you had to appeal to extra-constitutional means. And it was in that period, in 68, 69, that the left began to examine the possible uses of political violence.
Dotson, why do you call them left, since they're not Marxist, really, except for this superficial overlay, and they're not Leninist, except for some more slogans? Why do you use the word left? Is it as accidental as the geography of the Constituent Assembly in 1789?
I think within the spectrum of American...
Why isn't it fascist?
Within the spectrum of American political opinion...
Why is fascist right?
Exactly.
Well,
I quite agree with you.
In terms of the relationship of forces, then.
Yeah, in terms of the relationship in America, to be social democratic, even if you're not traditionally Marxist, even to be social democratic in the sense that Harold Wilson is.
Yeah, but he's not beyond that. He's not talking about the brief social democratic phase of the SDS. Mm. He's really talking about the SDS that is associated with stopping the university's cold, the kind of thing that happened in Columbia.
Well, I think it,
I this think was post the good-natured phase, or during
no, I think
it?
I think during the Columbia thing, events at Columbia, it was still in a reformist, in a reformist kind of political thrust, and I think it was the response of the police in that situation, out on the coast. That produced this continual movement to the left, and I'm talking about movement into Marxism.
Yeah, but you say in your book, Dotson, that the reason the New Left, and I'm, and that's the phrase, the reason the New Left was forcing these issues as strong as it was to get violence, and this violence from the police would thereby expose the inherent fascist nature of the state. So there was a sort of a contrived conspiratorial approach.
Well, you're confusing two books.
Like misquoted you?
No, you haven't misquoted me. I mean, you've taken two quotes and put a couple of them together. At Columbia.
Nothing unusual.
At Columbia.
Your second book, Post Good Natured.
Yes. At Columbia, the whole point of the occupation followed the whole idea of confrontation politics as developed from 1965 in the first demonstrations in Washington, i.e., that through confronting, in other words, that you take young men, and the left is, active left is like 80% young men. By young, I mean between 16 and 20. And you take
16 and 17.
Maybe. And you take young men who have a natural a rebellion in them, a desire to posit personhood and independence, and couple that with a kind of romanticism, which is innate to American students, to many American students, you've got to give them an enemy. And one of the things we very quickly learned is if they could come to realize that the enemy was around the corner in the form of the police or in the form of the school or whatnot, and go through a violent situation, they would be radicalized by it. It's just almost like Christian conversion. Whereas in the course of several days, literally could abandon one set of political beliefs for another.
Well, let me... So see if I can pick up a theme here. It is a fact that during 1968 and 69, 1970, certain kinds of protests, if you like, became quite common. Mm. And during that same period, there was an academic orchestration provided for people who thought that they had a sovereign right, for instance, to prevent their fellow students from listening to people they wanted to listen to. And a very, very a sophisticated explanation was given for this. For instance, in Mr. Beichman's book, he quotes a professor of English in Harvard University who, when confronted by the fact that some students invited scholars to defend the Vietnam War and were prevented from doing so in the spring of 1971, he made the point that, well, after all, the people who were protesting, those who were speaking, were themselves exercising their freedom of speech, and under the circumstances, all you got was a neutralized situation. Now, that kind of sophistry would not have been widely tolerated 10 years ago, even 5 years ago. The ACLU would have been all over the place.
But you're dealing with a very...
So there was a certain poison in the system. I think that's the point of Weichmann's book, Nine Lies Against America.
But you're dealing with a very complex...
I don't care how complex it is. I still try to understand it.
I think you can't, a lot of rhetoric, whether it's right or left, you can't take at face value.
Well, why not?
No, wait a minute. And you have to take it in terms of the reasons it's being, the motives behind its employment.
That's known as the objective situation.
I'm trying to make a very honest,
trying to
reach some sort of understanding of why the left adopted certain tactics and why it's adopted certain tactics now. I think in the period of 68 and 69 is the pivotal year in the terms of the New Left, because the year at which the non-pacifist left, and we all began as, I began on the student peace union, we all began as pacifists and as humanists and existentialists, and the whole movement of my life and everyone I know in the left has been a movement away from a pacific position to a more violent one, to the acceptance more and more of violent tactics. In 69 is when the left began to go underground. And when the left began to break up in terms of wide national organizational structures into affinity groups and began to respond very definitely to growing police repression. Now, in terms of rhetoric and in terms of demonstrations and devices used, and even in terms of opposition to the war, which I see largely as an organizational issue. The whole point of revolutionaries, I'm not one, I believe in revolution. I mean, I think I support the idea of a revolution in this country. I'd like to see a revolution.
What kind?
Then if you're, let me just finish this one point. If you're...
You're so tantalizing.
If you're a writer, which I am, or if you're an organizer, which, say, Dellinger is, regardless of whether you're on the pacifist left or you're on the Weatherman left, the whole point of the thrust of your life is to create subversives. It was to subvert American values, subvert American institutions, and you do this through many ways. And the rhetoric used, your nine big lies, is a device, and a rather successful device, to break down trust built up between the people and their institutions. Now, I'm not, by saying that, I'm not admitting their lies.
It seems odd to say that it's a successful device on the eve of the largest landslide in American history for Richard Nixon.
Well, there's two opinions on that if you're on the left. I mean, you have two ways of looking at it.
There's a Marcusian business that the more Nixon, then the more violent the reaction.
Right. And I think that
That's why we welcome
Hitler. Nach Hitler kommen wir, is what the Communist Party said.
I wonder if that's what Ken Gallery had in mind when he nominated McGovern.
Nach Hitler, after Hitler, we will come, said the Communist Party. And then Hitler came and they destroyed the Communist Party. Didn't know the difference between a right wing von Schleicher, which tolerated a Communist Party, and a Nazi regime which would destroy them.
Do you suppose Jack Newfield lied in professing his admiration for McGovern?
Maybe he's lying now.
When he said he lied about Absinthe.
Exactly.
You got a Harvey Machuso problem.
That's right. You know, that's the double bluff. He's saying that because so-and-so. Now, one of the things that I take up in my ninth lie is this cry for what I call revolutionism. We must have a revolution. What kind of revolution does it have to be bloody to be a real revolution?
Preferably.
Well, Regis Debray's got a problem. In his interview, he had an interview
with Allende. He doesn't want anything genteel, 1688, does he?
Well, you see, the problem is Allende a real revolutionary or not? There hasn't been any bloodshed. And Regis Debray is having a lot of trouble trying to decide whether this is a real revolution. If you don't have, 100,000 people killed, a hecatomb of human hearts piled high for the Montezuma, is it really a revolution?
How about that?
Well, I see, with the complexity, you're talking about what draws me to the idea, personally, to the idea of revolution.
What kind of revolution?
Is not what draws Dave Dellinger, and not what draws Tom Hayden.
Do you have the same definition of revolution?
No, I don't think so. I think by revolution, we all mean the seizure of state power.
You mean by election?
No, not by election.
By coup d'etat?
No, I think by revolution in the streets, by the seizure of American institutions.
Well, if you have people in the streets milling around, they're going to be shot at by somebody.
I know.
So you want a violent revolution, is what you're suggesting.
I personally would welcome a violent revolution because personally, there's something in me personally that finds violence.
You find it sexy.
Well, who would you be shooting
at?
Who would you be shooting at if you were in the streets? Presumably, you'd have a Sten gun.
Well, probably you, if you came walking down the street.
Well, I don't take it as a joke. I'm very serious. I mean, I've had this happen before. I was shot at several times by revolutionaries and counter-revolutionaries, too, in Algeria, among other places, and in Vietnam. So it's nothing particularly new. I'd just like to know why you would be shooting at me.
Well, I have difficulty responding to questions like that because I'd view it...
But this is the reality of revolution.
Let me answer the question. I view it all very novelistically, almost voyeuristically, the whole thing. And
Stendhal.
I understand something about the impulses behind particularly young males' attraction to the employment of violent means, and something about what it says about their manhood and what it says about what American institutions do in terms of emasculation, the extension of adolescence, and so on, to the young male. Now, if you're going to talk about revolution, and we're going to talk about that kind of that segment of the left which welcomes Nixon's ascendancy and hopes Agnew follows him, you're talking about that part of the left which seeks to break down liberal democracy and the corporate liberal democracy in the United States by so dividing the country, that is, a proportion of the country. In other words, a good portion of the left's function is the advancement of despair.
Yeah, polarization.
Right. And it's to get a strong enough minority, it doesn't have to be very large, of the population who are so deeply into despair over the possibility of change within the system that they're willing to form an organization, a revolutionary underground, and use any means necessary to bring it down. And my, just the experience of my life in this country, I don't think any believe anymore you're going to bring about massive change in this country through democratic electoral means.
Is there some revolution you particularly like which you think has worked out really well?
Outside of the Paris Commune, you mean? I know you put that down.
Well, because no,
I'm curious.
Well.
I mean, I want to get a paradigm here.
Well, failure has its charms.
Who?
Failure has its charms.
You have certainly 50 million people
who call
kulaks
disappear. He didn't ask you about a charming revolution. He asked you about a successful revolution.
You like one that's worked out as the one. Give me an idea when you say revolution. Do you like the Algerian revolution, the Cuban, the Russian, the Chinese?
I like the
Turkish. Turks had a revolution.
I like the Cuban Revolution for 3 years.
But now they got Padillo in jail, so we're right back.
I don't like the Cuban Revolution for the same reason Dellinger has doubts about it.
And Susan Sontag is finally.
It's because of the treatment of the artist, their suppression of intellectual freedom.
Would not that have been predictable?
The treatment of homosexuals, the treatment of nonconformists of all kinds.
No machismo.
So I don't see any point in exchanging Castro for Batista. Speaking in terms of self-interest as a writer.
So therefore you're still talking about revolutions you don't like.
Yeah, a revolution. I like the Russian Revolution until the rise of Stalin.
Well, is there something inevitable became, in this revolution?
I think the Soviet Union became social fascist.
Mm-hmm. Is there any revolution which doesn't eventually, that you've known, which has not gone down? For example, the Israelis, would they have a revolution there? I mean, they won through conquest, they had a war. They fought off the feudal Arab lords. One could have a marvelous time defining the Israelis.
It's not a revolution, though. It's not what we
Why
mean.
Not? The Histadrut, it's a labor movement. It controls the economy of Israel. There are no very rich people, no very poor people. I mean,
well,
why isn't that a revolution?
I support the state of Israel.
No, I'm not talking about that.
You know, but I think
I'm trying
a
to
revolution.
Find. I can
you,
listen.
You would send judge to Israel, right?
Pardon?
You would send judge to Israel.
Yeah.
But I'm trying to see.
Things I believe in collective guilt. You see?
You believe in collective innocence too?
I suppose I do, yeah.
Well, if everybody's innocent, nobody's innocent, yeah. As we say. What revolution do you find? In my book, I tried.
All you want me to do is give you an answer, so then I can mention. If I mention North Vietnam, so then you can drop.
Napalm.
All over me.
Why don't you just say there is no revolution that quite meets my standards?
There is no, and that's true.
Sure.
Yes, there is no.
So therefore, you're suggesting since the past is no guide to
more
the future,
perfect
we have to have the best revolution in the world, and if a few people get knocked off in the process.
How about the American Revolution?
Ça va?
I think it was a merchant's revolution, but I think it was a good revolution. And I think American democracy functioned well and worked well.
Until
nearly the Civil War, until the birth of national corporations and the beginning of state, beginning of federal intervention in localities and regions. I think Lincoln, who in many ways was a great man, is more than any other president responsible for this political and social arrangement we have in this country. The deep connection between the federal government and corporations and American institutions. And I think up to that point where American democracy was largely local, it was good and it functioned good. And that's kind of democracy I'd like to return to.
Well, in point of fact...
That's very romantic.
And the only way to do that...
In point of fact, historically, there were far fewer civil liberties in pre-Civil War America than there were in post-Civil War America. John Roach has written a convincing history on the point, and this was back when he was head of the ADA, so you don't have to distrust him.
But oh, but he would.
But he would.
No, but I'd like to ask you this. It may be that that which was briefly a fear experienced by the majority in America about revolutionary activity has turned now into contempt, and that the contempt is less because of the lack of efficacy of your movement than because of its total absence of intellectual credentials. And Arnold Beichman's book takes statements from representative leaders of that movement and shows that they are, for the most part, fantasies. They simply don't relate to anything that's going on in this country. Tom Wolfe, in his introduction, quotes Revel as saying, rather wistfully to his fellow European intellectuals, how come since I've been hearing for 50 years that America is where fascism is coming, all of the refugees tend to go from Europe to America rather than in the other direction. Now, can you tell us what it is that has been advanced by the whole sum of your labors and that of your colleagues over the last 7 or 8 years in terms of an understanding of the necessity for revolution or the likelihood of it?
Well, I think, I think McGovern's nomination is a product of the anti-war movement, which probably Mr. Nixon thanks us for, but it is largely, and I think the country as a whole, in terms of questions on the on abortion, on all sorts of, on pornography, on greater freedom in terms of the arts, on greater tolerance.
Aren't these cultural achievements?
Yeah, they are, largely.
But far more than political.
Yeah, they are.
I think that's a very important distinction.
But we've made a great deal of achievement. The country has moved left.
Culturally
left.
But not politically.
Right, and if you're, part of our belief is that the first thing you change, first thing that occurs before political change is cultural change. You have to change the consciousness of people.
That's not true. You see, Michael Oshak, for example, who I admire as one of the great conservative thinkers of our time, the English Don at London School of Economics, Michael Oshak is politically a great conservative. Culturally, I would say he was a radical. He doesn't believe in a great many of the controls that one would think a conservative does. And I think it's a great mistake to think that conservatives politically are conservatives culturally. On the contrary, I think they're not. You see. And I don't think it necessarily follows that a left culture necessarily produces a left politics.
No, but I think you've got to, I personally believe you've got to change people's sexual attitudes, people's attitude towards the church, people's attitude toward education, towards business.
Sex attitudes have changed fantastically. The most important revolution which has taken place, as Pat Moynihan once said, in America is the way the boys and the girls have all moved in together at American university dormitories.
Right.
Something inconceivable 3 years ago.
Right.
Now every administrator says, well, thank God we're out of the boarding house business. Boarding house. Now that's been a very important change in manner, and mamas and papas now look upon it as perfectly, you know, nothing to argue about. It's better than the divorce, and at least he's straight, as Mama would say. Now this has been a very
Mama?
But you know that's been an amazing change, and I think the sex attitudes can change. I think this has perhaps been where there has been achievement, sort of a would-be quote avant-garde, surrealist. The school in terms of manner and culture has to change the politics. Can you change the politics of a highly integrated industrialized society where you have a fairly good amount of affluence, blacks moving in, en bourgeoisement, the slogan of the day? Can't you have left culture? After all, the middle class in America today just loves being denounced. They think they just go and pay big money to go and see movies like The Graduate, in which they made a laughing stock of. Then they go back in a nice middle class, right to the same swimming pool they were laughing at in the movie.
Well, what's the point?
The point I'm making is that you may have achieved a cultural revolution, which is quite possible in changing manners, modes, consciousness, but the political revolution is something which may escape the clutches of this cultural revolution. Because it has no ideology. You just revolution?
I think part of the thrust of the left has been to encourage dropping out of the system by, you're not going to like this, the most sensitive and the most gifted intellectually of the young. And that's why drugs, for example, are a device, and sexual promiscuity and sexual deviancy is a device. Any device by which a person becomes an outlaw within his own country makes him by definition a rebel. Therefore, natural allies to a revolutionary movement, whether they're conscious of it or not, are women who undergo illegal abortions, are people on drugs, people who take drugs, are homosexuals, are anyone who is by definition, an outlaw.
Charles Manson would be a rebel by that formula, right?
Well, I would.
So
if you took it to a ludicrous point.
And Bernadine Dorn, who enjoyed the fork going into the victim's stomach. Or wow, man,
Sirhan,
would
Sirhan.
Be a rebel too.
Sirhan, Sirhan would be.
No,
would
you, I'm not. Wait a minute. I don't. It's a serious point I make. So don't.
No, you say people who isolate themselves from the conventions of society.
Right, which is not to say that. Which is not to say that you
shoot Bobby Kennedy.
Which is not to say that you necessarily think what they do is good. But you want. But you.
I'm not speaking what you advocate.
Generically, they do foster the revolutionary spirit by pulling out of it.
But what is the politics of this? Is what I don't understand is that you want to see, let's say, in the best sense of the word, and I don't mean in any red-baiting sense, a communist society, an anarchism, you know, anarcho-syndicalism. I don't quite understand the politics of the word revolution. I understand the culture that you talk about in terms of revolution. I don't understand the politics of it. What would be the power structure? Would there be a Politburo? Would there be a dictatorship? Would George Meany be sitting, you know, in Elba or someplace?
A constitution written by Marquis de Sade. He is a revolutionary.
Yeah, that very important revolution. We can have the Olympia Press sell it in all the bookstores and make fortunes for everybody.
Oh, no, you can't make fortunes. Sorry.
No, there's got to be
pornography, what do you
no
do with
fortune.
The money?
It has to be a little
what do you do with the money?
Burn it.
What do you do with your property?
You're asking me a question I have no answer to. What you're asking is what
this
comes...
This is the most successful guest you've ever... It's the first time I've ever heard a guest on your program say he has no answer. This may be a historic moment.
What comes after the revolution? I don't know.
And, you know, this is what Lenin had the same problem. The day after the revolution, he said, he complains in one of his writings, Marx never told us what we do tomorrow morning. What do you do now? So he had some vague ideas like everybody gets the same salary, the worker and the factory manager, until finally they had to drop that idea. And then you have to do a lot of things, as it turns out, Stalin did a couple of things which turned out to have been very bad, like calling people kulaks and killing 15 million or maybe 30 million.
You see, but the
act of the revolution, my boy, is everybody's for good and virtue. Robespierre, incorruptible Robespierre.
The difference is between this generation and revolutions, say, of the 19th century, is we're not interested fundamentally in equality. We're fundamentally interested in justice, which means that we have a greater tolerance for ideas of liquidating a class and so on. And I think that comes from the idea, comes
a
from
class.
I'm just in the motives for why.
This is, you're talking about murder. This is the way people get categorized, a class. Jews, gypsies, and Catholics. You don't see people. You see Jews, Catholics, and gypsies, and they march you off, as you like to say in your book, to the gas chambers quietly.
I didn't see that in my book.
You had some reference in one of the books about they marched off quietly, these little boys who were being taken in somewhere, into Washington, some quote concentration camps. They went like the Jews into the gas chambers. When you talk about the word class, don't you see people? Is it that fixed that you can say you're to be shot and you're to live? And who the hell are you to say
whole
so?
Thing of
and why shouldn't I shoot you?
The
in
whole,
case?
the whole,
which I'm not,
ability to function as a revolutionary, which I'm not. The whole ability to function as one depends upon the ability to depersonalize
people.
Your enemy.
People.
If you personalize personalize your enemy, you can't act.
That's right. As Jerry Rubin said, you've got to be prepared to shoot your mother.
That's right.
That's pretty straightforward.
What I find difficult about you, Dotson, you keep saying I'm not a revolutionary, but you're busy explaining it in very understanding, very charming and elegant prose, and I keep thinking about the boys who were always busy understanding Hitler. Of course, he's an uncouth barbarian. I'm not a Nazi, but you do have to understand that Jews own all the department stores in Berlin.
I support the idea of revolution. If revolution came, I would support it. I haven't the.
How would you support it?
I know enough about myself that
by running the mimeograph machine or running the machine gun.
I don't have the physical courage to be willing to die. I don't want to die, and I'm not willing to die for the revolution or anything else. I mean, I know that enough about myself. I have no physical courage at all. And what draws me into situations of political violence is not courage, but a kind of psychological need in me to involve myself that
Why don't
way.
You take up flying
airplanes? I also know that I am part of a class, and am part of a privileged class, that would be liquidated. I mean, they may get you first, but they'd get me next. And I know that absolutely.
They gotta get George Meany first before they can get me.
So, but it doesn't matter to me, because I want revolution to come. And the reasons for it are very complex.
And what happens afterward doesn't matter.
Well, I don't think I'll be around to see, you know.
Well, is this an act of a dying religion, you know?
No, I mean, it seems very rare.
You don't know what it's going to be. You don't know what it's going to lead. You can see that there'll be some...
See, you're continually trying to find rationality behind what people do politically, particularly what the left does politically.
Oakshot,
you don't understand the whole...
Like
the thrust of the left is...
Oakshot wouldn't like that.
...is against reason. It's anti-rational. That's why it's anarchistic and nihilistic. It's anti-rational. And then when you demand...
Then why do you have to treat it like something intelligent? Why not just put it all in those sort of in loony bins? I mean, people are going to talk in revolution because it's irrational.
Yeah, but
I mean, how do they differ from somebody like Mar Assad, who are the lunatics?
No, you can say, I was saying, the motivation behind it is not rational. Because most people, including myself, who came to their political position, came to it experientially rather than intellectually.
But Sartre wouldn't accept that,
and,
would he?
And why, when we do something, if I took a position on the war and so on, I take it on the basis of rational grounds and logic and so on. But the motivation behind, say, the desire for these abstractions, doesn't come intellectually. It comes emotionally. It comes out of the gut. And that's why that's why attacking the left for this and attacking the left.
But
you
look at
a very rational argument, but it doesn't work.
But is it really a left?
Because you're not dealing with what exactly the motivation is behind these people, because you don't understand it.
Wait a minute. Let me ask.
But it's not a left.
Hang on a sec. Let me ask you this. If you were in effective charge of the military-industrial complex, would you proceed simply to eliminate the revolutionary class, those of them with, as you put it, with physical courage?
I think people, as Thomas Jefferson said, have a right to revolution. They have a right to overthrow a government they no longer want. I think the government has a duty to resist that.
That is one of the most misstatements of Thomas Jefferson.
It is. But quite apart from that, would you, as a matter of policy or strategy, if you were head of the military-industrial complex, would you order the elimination of those people who threatened you?
I think, well, if I were head of the military-industrial complex in this country,
yeah. Mm-hmm.
I think one could, within a year, totally reduce the left.
You could.
And
how many people would be involved in the execution of about how many people?
I don't think it would take execution.
What would it take?
I think you buy off the left.
Visiting professorships?
No, I think basically you could buy off the left in this kind of the way England buys it off.
And how does England do that?
You give them access.
You mean upward mobility?
Yeah, you give them access to power. It doesn't have to be the ultimate power.
But
it's the same way Lindsay buys off blacks in this town. Mm-hmm. You know, he gives them poverty projects. Look at Floyd McKissick. Floyd McKissick is sold out, lock, stock, and barrel, to the Nixon administration because he's gotten several million in federal funding to build Soul City. And Floyd McKissick started off very low. In fact, I did a television show with him about 2 years ago, and he agreed with everything I said.
Why did he sell out, by the way?
No, he supports the Nixon administration. And he's gone in 2 years from...
But suppose it's his judgment that the black people for whom he is fighting are profiting more from the Nixon administration than they would from a Jerry Rubin administration.
No, I think that change in judgment comes from the fact that he, as a black man, is profiting.
Why do you doubt his motives?
Maybe I shouldn't doubt his motives.
Well, maybe you shouldn't, but you
did. But I've seen too many... I've known too many leftists.
Well, apparently you say everybody that you've associated with could be had.
No, I'm not saying that. No, I'm saying there's one...
You said within a year. That's what you said, within a year.
That was one of the ways. Mm-hmm. I'm not going to give you a program to liquidate my friends, you know. But there are a number of ways you could do it. The government's response to the left has been very bad.
Your friends are doing well enough.
Yeah.
It's been very bad. And I think the government's chief mistake was forcing the left underground. And if I were Mr. Nixon... See, the only thing that, if I were you, I would be bothered by, I would really want McGovern to win. Because if McGovern loses, there's going to be a lot of young people, and people who have been active in the anti-war movement, who are going to become very disillusioned, and a lot of options, which we've thought morally and ethically are closed to us, are suddenly going to be open again.
What if the war ends? Would they be disillusioned then? They probably will, to come think of that.
Yeah, I think you're going to see, after the election, you're going to see an increase in terrorist activities on the part of the left. And governmentally, in terms of maintaining some sort of social order, it's very stupid to force your opponents underground. It's very stupid to do.
What makes you think they're underground?
Because I know they're underground.
And maybe the FBI or other agency would know they're underground. It's much safer to let them stay
there.
Well,
they haven't caught Mark Rudd yet, have they?
Maybe they don't want to catch him.
Well, maybe they don't.
Is Rudd a fugitive?
Huh?
Is Rudd a fugitive?
Yes.
I didn't know that.
Yeah. Many of Bernie Dorn and so on. It may well be that they're underground and can't function. It's very hard to function underground. One of the problems that Lenin found in making revolutions, it's very hard to function underground. You can't keep touch. And it may be the most effective thing
that is. If you're serious about stopping the left and stopping all this.
But it's not
the way to do it is to stop the war, it's to stop poverty. Guaranteed annual income.
But you can never stop poverty.
Is to open the country.
No,
is the point
that
you
want somebody receiving less than anybody else.
You want to stop the opposition to the system, then you've got to change the system to take from it, much like Franklin Roosevelt did.
But look, you just said a minute ago, Dotson, that the left, you can't talk about it in rational terms. Now you've let go a rational program, end the war, make everybody better off than they were before, then you'll get rid of the left. So the left is rational. Because it can respond rationally.
And the result of that is you isolate. What you haven't done is you isolate the core, the revolutionary core. And the point, it seems to me, any government from Bismarck on who's dealt effectively with the left has always done it by isolating the extremity of the left. And that's exactly what the government here isn't doing.
Well,
I mean, these people function underground because they have friends
above ground. We
turn to our panel, Professor Ned Lebow, Assistant Professor of Political Science at CCNY. You have a question?
Yes, I do. You seem to see revolution more as
this is directed at whom?
At Dotson Rader. Mm-hmm. More as an art form, an aesthetic experience, rather than as political action, which personally I find both naive and dangerous. Mm. But the question really is this, that you're concerned with justice and humanity, but not with people. You want to provide greater self-expression and freedom in the world, but you're willing to suppress people's freedom to achieve this goal. You condemn the system for its lack of sensitivity, yet you want to impersonalize revolutionaries to achieve its overthrow. Now, don't you think that history reveals in general that revolutions achieved by violence, which produce great structural changes, bring to power leaders who tend to be authoritarian, charismatic, and who tend to suppress the very liberties and freedoms which you think revolution would achieve?
It's probably all true. But I don't think history has much effect on what people do.
I thought we were marching with history. You said that in one of your articles, that history is on our side.
I'm always contradicting myself. That's one.
That's one of your charms.
I'm just like Mr. Buckley.
That's one of your charms. We march with history on Mondays, Tuesdays, and Thursdays.
Professor Gerald Mannheim.
So I'd like to ask principally Mr. Rader, but also Mr. Beichman. The term cultural revolution has really been bandied about a good deal today. And a cultural revolution implies that there's a basic conflict between at least two different sets of values. Mm. And I would like to raise the question of whether, particularly in the United States today, there is really such a basic conflict of values, or whether instead there's a disagreement over whether the agreed basic values are being implemented properly.
I think the original stepping off point for all of us was the sense of disillusionment over commonly accepted values which weren't being implemented. I think in the last decade, an alternative value system has arisen, and which is in conflict with the commanding values in this country. And it's that alternate system which produces subversives.
Professor, do you want to answer that also, Mr.
Well, I think there is a conflict. In terms of a cultural revolution in this country. It's a conflict which I think shows itself probably best in the fight on obscenity and pornography and what's happened over the past 3 years in terms of the openness of sale, the massage parlors, and so on. It raises anew the old question, does a society suffer when everything becomes open, when everything becomes accessible in terms of sexuality? I think there, does the government belong in the bedroom, the old controversy? And I think there you have a very serious question which hasn't been resolved and may not be. Should we have censorship? My good friend Irving Kristol is a believer in censorship. In other words, censor it, make it underground, not above ground. So if you want it that badly, you've got to go looking for it, but not as open. These are some of the questions, I think, which have not been resolved in terms of values in any democratic society.
Professor Schneier?
Yeah, I think Mr. Beichman's got an awful little easy here.
Maybe he has too.
So maybe let me try something on him. From one of your first questions to Mr. Rader, you said, what do you mean by power to the people? And his answer, I think, was rather vague. But maybe I'd ask you the same question. If not power to the people, power to whom? And if power to the people, isn't that a real and serious problem now as to how you achieve that in any way?
Yeah. If we're not using it as a slogan, then I think it's a very serious question. One of the reasons I spent as many years as I did in the trade union movement is I was very much interested in working people. And as you see, I got a lot out of it. Teaching politics, University of Massachusetts, my Elba. power of the people in that sense is very important. I made a great discovery in the labor movement. There's nothing like getting somebody who hasn't got very much, a 10% wage increase, a health and welfare program, an opportunity for a kid through a scholarship program to go to a university. I began to learn the importance of bread and butter trade unionism, for which many intellectuals who will have a nice split level existence and take winter vacations as well as summer ones find very contemptible. It was the young bourgeois in Paris during the 68 uprising, the events of May, who felt so terrible that workers didn't want to continue the general strike into a total revolution, you see.
Yeah, but in a sense, it seems to me that there is a kind of elitism in that response, that an aspect of the new left that I don't think has been brought out very clearly here, I think is legitimately pointing toward and saying, you know, the emperor has no clothes or something of this
meaning
kind. Meaning that I think that there's a big difference that Lincoln never reconciled between government by the people and government for the people. And you're talking in a sense about government for the people.
No, government by the people. A trade union is run, if it's any kind of a decent trade union, by the people in that trade union.
Well,
they vote on strikes, they vote on settlements. We know that. Maybe sometimes, unfortunately.
And their choices and their leaders are so gifted, they never have to change them.
Their what?
Their choices and their leaders are so gifted, they never have to change them.
Like whom?
Meany.
Delegates all the time, they keep voting for it. How about another union?
I say, he hasn't had...
Yeah.
He hasn't been overthrown in years. No, this is a problem. May I say this, Mr. Schneier? I think that... I think that the notion of power to the people I find repugnant in the sense that I can't consider of a civilized order that is one in which the individual doesn't have rights.
Exactly.
And if you give power to the people, then you don't have things like bills of rights.
But you
how
never
about
give
the
power
rights
to
of the
people?
Guy on the assembly line at Lordstown or something of this kind of thing? You see, I mean, I think that there is a sense in which some greater form of participation in basic decision-making processes, not just at the macro level of deciding about the war in Vietnam and this kind of thing, which
right.
is incredibly
well, and
complex.
The freer the society, the freer the actual choices he has. One of the reasons why we have such fluctuating employment figures is because we accept a frictional unemployment figure as high as 5%. Now, these are people changing jobs. Now, the people who are changing jobs are not all because they've been fired from a job, but they have been bid away or they're not interested in their job, they don't like it, they go somewhere else. There's a great deal of that in America. And I think that this is the way that one most eloquently asserts oneself as opposed to the kind of work that you describe, if in fact you find it temperamental for whatever other reason to meaning.
But I think that you're in a sense talking about, and not just in this statement, but in things I've read of yours, the kind of freedom of the elephant dancing among the chickens. And you're talking about two elephants dancing. The chickens still aren't involved.
Who are the chickens?
Yeah.
All power to the chickens?
Yeah.
No, who are, yeah.
Well, if they're chickens,
see, in that respect, I don't think you're addressing yourself to his question. While the American worker can certainly change jobs, he goes from being the pawn in one organization to a pawn in a second organization, which could be argued as very little choice. What I believe Ned is talking about is restructuring the society in a way to give people more direct power.
Is there anybody done this, by the way? Do you have?
Well, look at the Yugoslav example.
Some specific country?
With respect to worker involvement. With respect to worker involvement in factories.
Where?
The Volvo factory in Gothenburg. In Yugoslavia or Sweden, where this experiment...
Now you're not going to give me Yugoslavia. I studied the workers' council.
Wrote about that in 1905.
And
it was generally assumed that the costs were too high because you surrendered all of your political liberty and much of your personal liberty.
Bill, depends how you determine costs.
Bill, we can't let this Yugoslav nonsense go by that easily.
Okay, but hurry.
How many seconds do we have to dispose of Tito's workers' council?
You have a minute and a half to dispose of Tito.
The workers' councils in Yugoslavia don't have power over. The control is exercised by bank loans, interest rate, just like in good capitalist countries. I've made a study of them. I've been there. I've visited them. See how much control there is by the workers when it comes to control, like shop stewards have control. But to talk about control and involvement, why do you think you have the disaffection today in Yugoslav industrial production? Is it only nationalism in Croatia? You can't. The Workers' Council is one of the myths which have been successful in giving liberals and liberal intellectuals a way out. This is a better kind of society.
I thought you were a liberal intellectual.
No, I'm a trade union reactionary who's teaching politics.
Well, would you concede, Mr. Rader, that you can't have power for the people side by side with a bill of inalienable human rights?
No, I wouldn't concede that.
Well, suppose the people decide to take away your rights. Who wins?
It's
either alienable or it's inalienable.
No, I think when we use the phrase power to the people, we're talking about several broad questions. One is decentralization. One is the socialization of industry on a very local level. The introduction on the assembly line level, on the smallest level, of control of workers over their working conditions. In other words, as far as is humanly and institutionally possible, to give people the power to affect those institutions that affect their lives directly.
Well,
directly to give them the power.
That's the whole point of personal freedom.
Yes.
And the whole point of organizations.
Yes.
But obviously somebody's freedom...
Half the strikes of the United Automobile Workers are frequently on those local working conditions, not even on wages, trying to assert the right over the job and production output and quotas. That's the reason that the last GM strike lasted as long as it did was because
of
personal and local
issues. We don't believe you're going to have that, you're really going to have that until the workers own the plants, until the people own the plants. Until you get rid of a capitalist class.
Well, are you able to point to plants that are owned by the people, for instance, the coal mining plants in Great Britain, in which there is a very detectable euphoria among the workers there that the people who work for, say, the telephone company or General Motors don't have?
Not in England, I can't.
Why not?
But I think his point about Yugoslavia...
Why not? They're nationalized. A lot of industries.
But you haven't. I've been out to the agricultural implement manufacturing plant outside of Belgrade. The workers are the most disaffected in the world. Because every time they vote to use the profits to build a swimming pool, mm-hmm. they end up finding it impossible the next year to get a loan to expand production. That's how the government gets even with them.
Yeah, but
have no control. This is a workers'
state.
I don't
know what the point is.
The point I'm making is that when you say all power to the people, there's a little thing you forget. The people are just a vague, amorphous entity.
The point is that
economic democracy is exercised primarily by mobility and through the marketplace, not through political organization.
Are you saying they shouldn't have the right to build a swimming pool?
I say they should have the right, exactly. I'm in favor of that. Except that when you give an example of workers' councils in Yugoslavia, you're talking again about the same fiction, the same dream that people... Lenin said Soviets plus electricity equals socialism. All these marvelous slogans.
Workers ought to have the right to make mistakes.
Well, then don't give examples about Yugoslavia. Absolutely. Absolutely.
He didn't. It wasn't he.
Brought it and said, like, as in Yugoslavia.
Oh, I see, yeah. Mr. Mannheim?
At the risk of changing the topic, I think I'd like to change the topic.
Sure.
Now, Mr. Rader suggested that the Vietnam War and opposition to the war was essentially an organizational issue for the new left. And that, I think, leads into another question, which is, to what extent is the new left dependent on technology, and particularly on communications technology? For its organization and for its sustenance.
I see. I meant that. I didn't mean that the opposition to the war wasn't real and wasn't moral and didn't come out of an ethical sense of outrage, deep and profound, over a war we think is unjust. We're talking about the creation of subversives, if I remember. And the war is the only issue we have at the moment. We've tried others.
But could you create subversives if you didn't have,
no, you've got to have
instant technology?
I don't think in an industrialized country you can, no. I think we need the access to the media. And that's one of our problems at the moment, is we don't get the access to the media.
Mr. LeBeau, you had a question?
Yes, at the risk of bringing up that former topic, I think what's really at the core of the problem here is the old Marxist question of the alienation of man from his labor. And what we're talking about is some means of restoring freedom by making the individual feel he's doing something meaningful over which he has some degree of control. And if perhaps the Yugoslav example, for a variety of reasons, hasn't shown the promise that it might have, that's no reason to discard the baby
research
with the bathwater, as
quite
it were. And one could look at the Chinese example.
Or we could look at the kibbutz,
concept,
or the
kibbutz.
What Buber
right
referred to as communitarian socialism. And even there you find in the kibbutzim an alienation of young people who want to go to the flesh pots of Tel Aviv. This
good
is the
for
problem.
Them.
Huh? Yeah, that's
them
right. See, one of the problems is we talk about specific countries and systems when it may be that man may be the problem under any system. And fremd alienation is a problem under any system, perhaps.
So
it's man
saying
himself.
We need a new man, right?
Yeah, we do need maybe a new man. But it may not be the new man that Marcuse or you have found for us. That will be the new, maybe it'll have to be a Buber who will find an I-thou relationship. I don't know. Mm. But maybe it's going to have to be somebody.
Sentimental,
on the contrary. I think that Buber may have something in the sense of individual establishing a relationship with outside of himself, outside of his own sexuality, as you might
well,
like to
say. Well, in a sense,
say
that's what the left is about, at least the student left.
Except
is about
Buber
the
doesn't
want
to pull triggers on
it's about
people.
The search
that's
for
the problem.
Why don't you let me finish the point? It's about the search part for I'm supporting you. About the search for transcendence,
I worry about
right?
that. I suspect Rader bringing gifts.
Mr. Schneid, do you have a final question?
No, I have one. I mean, the part of the romanticism that really gets me here is I think that you go back even further than Mr. Buckley in historical epics. And, I mean, the thing that I think it was Governor Long once said to Leander Perez, you know, Leander, what you going to do now? The Fed's got the H-bomb. And I think it's an appropriate question in terms of your talk about revolution here. I mean, what you're really talking about is this kind of revolution, you know, suicide.
Well, I think part of what we've learned to appreciate is the delicacy of highly technologized post-industrial countries, America. Their incredible vulnerability, the most primitive of devices. I mean, the Arabs sending those letters.
What's the vulnerability there, really? I mean,
you can stop New York City, for example.
And what if you happen? Suppose you stop New York City. Supposing New York City was seized in a conspiracy, what would you lose? Wall Street? Mayor Lindsay? I mean, what would happen? Would the country stop moving? See, this is one of the romantic myths.
I was trying to reply to his point. The government has the H-bomb. Well, I think I think you reach a certain point of power where it becomes irrelevant, as it is in Vietnam.
Tiger. There are commensurate weaknesses.
Right.
Thank you very much, Mr. Rader. Thank you, Mr. Beichman. Thank you, gentlemen of the panel.
Bound copy of this program, send 25 cents in coin to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. That's 25 cents to Firing Line, Post Office Box 5966, Columbia, South Carolina 29250. This program was made possible by a grant from the Corporation for Public Broadcasting. This is a presentation of the Southern Educational Communications Association.